Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to another session on banking and finance important terms. Today again, we are going to discuss a lot of important banking and finance terms, which are certainly going to help you in understanding the core of finance as well as core of banking and economics in a much better manner. Let me take you through the contents table through which you'll be able to understand better as to what all we are going to cover today. And then we'll start with them one by one. The first one that we're going to cover is Lysis Fair Policy, then Near Money, Overdraft, OTC Market, what exactly is OTC Market, and what differentiates it from an exchange traded market. What's the prime rate, technically BPLR, Benchmark Prime Lending Rate, Tied Loan, Warrants, Wholesale Banking, how is it different from retail banking, very favorite question of the interview board, Lead Bank Scheme, Local Area Banks, Chit Funds, Nidhis, Asian Clearing Union, Hundi, CRISIL, ICRA, CARE, all these are rating agencies, ONICRA, DFHI, and NEET, and how is it connected with BOLT that we've already covered. Okay, so these are the terms that we're going to cover today one by one. So without wasting any time, let us start with them. The first one that we have today is called as Lysis Fair. What exactly is the meaning of Lysis Fair? Let me change it here. Yes, this is perfect. So what exactly is the meaning of Lysis Fair? If we translate it into English, it comes out to be let us do it on our own. Let us do it on our own, or let us leave it alone, something like that. So the primary meaning of Lysis Fair policy is a policy wherein the government is not involved in economic or any other kinds of policies. The primary role of government is to stick to citizens' rights. So it focuses on protecting. It focuses on protecting citizens' rights. This is the major work of the government. Whereas all kinds of other activities, including economic activities on a major basis, on a major role, are focused upon by the people themselves. So the people are telling the government, let us do it. Please do not interfere in creating economic policies, trying to be welfarist in nature, trying to control market forces and the private sector. So the government should not intervene in the economy. Okay. Another word which people normally confuse with Lysis Fair is caveat emptor. Caveat emptor, which means that let the buyer beware. So this is a policy which is normally followed, especially in capitalist economies and in economies where you let the market decide what is best for the customer and the customer decide what is best for himself. So if there is any problem with, let's say you go tomorrow and buy shop for something, let's say you shop for a pair of jeans, and then that pair of jeans turns out to be faulty. So if you, it is upon you, the onus is upon you to ensure that whatever you're buying is not faulty. If it is faulty, turns out to be faulty, some kind of manufacturing defect, something, you have recourse to the Consumer Protection Act, wherein you can go to the court. However, the buyer has to beware. He cannot say that he was ignorant or unaware of something that happened and therefore he wants a recourse. That is not acceptable. So he can say that the company did not provide him with a decent product, that the product that was provided was faulty. However, he certainly cannot say that he was unaware of something that happened and therefore he had to go through some kind of loss. Okay, so the buyer has to beware. The next term that we have is near money. Near money. What exactly is near money? So these are highly liquid assets which are not cash right now, but they can be easily converted into cash. So these are nothing but highly liquid assets. So assets which are highly liquid in nature. For example, bills of exchange. Bills of exchange, they can be converted into cash almost immediately. Savings accounts, marketable securities, money market instruments, various other money market instruments. If you hold these instruments, you can almost certainly convert them into cash immediately within 30 days, and that's why they're called as highly liquid assets. So at the same time, they're also providing you certain returns, and along with these returns, they also maintain nature of being highly liquid. That's why they are very attractive. So this is called as near money. I hope you've understood this. Okay, let's come to the next one. The next term that we have is overdraft. What exactly is the meaning of overdraft? Let's say you have a current account in a bank. You have a current account. You are a businessman and you have a current account with the bank. Right now, let's say you have rupees 2 lakh in the bank account. And you give out a check by mistake. You did not realize that you have only rupees 2 lakh in the bank account, and you go give out a check of, let's say, 2,10,000. So the amount that you have in your account is less than the check. Therefore, the check will bounce. At the same time, because you have a current account, you will be provided certain overdraft facility. Let's say the overdraft facility is for 20,000 based upon the limit of your account, based upon the credibility of you as a business owner. So the overdraft facility provided to you by the bank is for rupees 20,000. That means up to a limit of 20,000, your account can go negative. So tomorrow, let's say the balance in your account is zero, and a person comes in and wants to withdraw rupees 20,000 through a check which has been issued by you to that person, he can do it. The bank will allow this person, this third person, to withdraw rupees 20,000. However, your balance now will be negative 20,000, and therefore you will be paying certain interest rate, certain percentage of interest rate on this negative value that you have in your account. This is called as overdraft facility. This is specially provided to only current account holders with the purpose of giving them more flexibility, so that if by mistake or because of some reason they end up having more withdrawals than the deposits, then they can carry on their business over a short period of time. Okay. The next term that we have is OTC market, over the counter market. What exactly is OTC market? So you have an exchange, and in an exchange, there is a digital market, there is a physical market where you can go in and trade with other people. However, OTC is a decentralized market. It's not a centralized market, it's a decentralized market, where trading is done directly between two parties, wherein me and you are trading with each other, but there is no central exchange existing, there is no broker existing. So what happens is, there is no regulation, we can have any kind of contract with each other, and at the same time, tomorrow, let's say the contract goes against you, the contract is in my favor, there will be more chances that you will withdraw from the contract, that you will default. So the disadvantage of an OTC market is default, whereas the major advantage of an OTC market is that it is customizable. That means we can have any kind of contract with each other, no matter how ridiculous the contract may sound to a third party, we can enter into any kind of contract, we can customize it according to our needs. Okay, that's the advantage. The major disadvantage, I hope you have understood. So this is called as OTC market. The next term that we have is called as prime rate. It is also called as was also called as BPLR, benchmark prime lending rate. What exactly is prime rate? Let us try and understand it. So the concept of BPLR says that, let's say I am a bank and in the process of lending out money, of course, I will be charging certain interest in terms of percentage. Now, there are two kinds of borrowers. Let's say there is an industrialist. Okay, this is an industrialist. And because he's a successful businessman, the chances of default are very less. The chances of default are very less, and the chances of complying with the loans, giving back the loans, are very high. On the other hand, let's say there is a farmer. There is a farmer, a small farmer, because we don't know how the farming activity, how agriculture turns out every year because of deviations in monsoon, so on and so forth. So we are not very sure whether the defaults are going to be more or less. So the chances of default are high. And at the same time, the credibility of this borrower is also not known because he has not taken a lot of loans in the past. He has no credit history whatsoever. I will certainly not be charging them the same rate of interest because the risk is low here, the risk is high here, risk of default. Okay, so let's say I charge him 8% of interest, then I will charge this farmer much higher than 8% interest. So I will charge him, let's say 8%, and because of excess risk of default, I will charge him an excess of 2.5%. So the rate now comes out to be 10.5%. Okay, so this rate of interest that I'm charging from the most prime borrowers is called as prime rate. This will be called as prime rate. The BPLR system was the system, benchmark prime lending rate system, which we'll be discussing in Indian banking system as well in the future. It's the system wherein the bank has to decide what its prime rate is going to be, and all the other interest rates are going to be dependent or are going to be pegged based on this prime rate. Now, the problem with this system was that banks started cross-subsidizing. So instead of charging 8%, I would say, because the risk is much less and the industrialist says that I don't have any risk, please give me lesser. So I will charge him 7%. And instead of charging him 10.5%, I would say 7%, because I'm letting go 1% here. So I'll add 1% there indirectly somehow. So I will say 7% plus 4.5%. I'll increase the risk interest that I've added because of extra risk, and I will say 11.5%. So the farmer loses because now he has to pay more, he does not have any bargaining power, and he does not have enough credibility in the market, whereas the industrialist saves money because he has to pay lesser interest rate than he should have paid. This is called as cross subsidization of interest rates by banks. So this used to happen when benchmark prime lending rate was in focus, was implemented, and therefore it was removed and replaced by base rate. Base rate was again further replaced by MCLR, and MCLR has been replaced by MCLR based on external benchmarking. So we had been MCLR based on internal benchmarking, now have MCLR based on external benchmarking. Okay, I hope you've understood prime rate. I've discussed more than what prime rate wanted to tell you. The next term that we have is called as tied loan. So what's a tied loan? The name itself, I think, clarifies what exactly it should mean. Tied loan is a loan which is provided by, let's say, a government to an individual, one government to another government, but it is tied because the loan specifies where it should be invested. For example, India gives a tied loan to Bangladesh and says that you're going to use this loan on housing for the poor people. In the past, we've given such loans to countries like Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh, etc., etc., which are all the neighbors of India. So let's say we give out a loan to Bangladesh and say that this loan is going to be invested in only low-cost housing for the poor people in, let's say, this part of the country. Bangladesh says, okay, I don't have any problem because anyways I need money for creating low-cost housing for these people. So this becomes a tied loan because the final or the end usage of this loan has been tied, has already been decided. Okay, the next term that we have is called as a warrant. What is a warrant? A warrant is an option which is issued by a company wherein the warrant holder, let's say you are the warrant holder is given a right to subscribe to equity shares at a predetermined price and, after a predetermined time period. So what happens in a warrant is, let me write it down. So what happens in a warrant is, let's say I am a company and I issue a warrant. This warrant is issued to an individual, and the warrant says that, let's say the warrant is issued on 1/1/2020, and it says on 1/1/2024, this individual will be given 1000 shares of, let's say, ABC company at the rate of, let's say, rupees 50 per share. So the time has been decided, the price has been decided, the number of shares has been decided. So this is a warrant because it gives the option to this individual to buy 1000 shares at rupees 50 on 1/1/2024. Now let's say on this exact date in the future, the price of this share in the market is, let's say, rupees 147 per share. Irrespective of what the price is in the market, I have the right to buy these shares at rupees 50. This is called as a share warrant. So this gives an option to the holder of the warrant. The next term that we have is called as wholesale banking. Let's understand what is wholesale banking and how is it different from retail banking. So what happens in a retail banking is, let's say tomorrow I want to go and buy a car, and let's say I buy a vehicle, okay? And I decide to take a loan on this vehicle. So I, as an individual, have purchased this car and I have got this car financed, which means that I have taken a loan on this car. Let's say the price of this car was 10 lakh and I decided to take a loan of, let's say, 5 lakh. So now this bank has given me a loan of rupees 5 lakh on this car. The loan has been given individually to me. This is called as retail banking. On the other hand, wholesale banking is a system wherein, instead of catering to the retail customers, instead of catering to individuals, the bank starts catering to institutions, societies, corporate houses, various institutional investors, other kinds of investors, real estate developers, brokers. So instead of focusing on individual one by one, the bank start focusing on groups, any kind of group, which might be providing some kind of services to someone else as well. For example, instead of providing loan individually to individuals to all these people who are coming to buy cars, let's say I attach myself with Ola. So I am the bank here. I attach myself with Ola, and Ola buys 100 cars in one go, and I provide them finance for all these cars immediately. So this will be wholesale banking, because instead of catering to individuals, instead of catering to retail customers, I am now in business with corporate houses like Ola, which are providing me a lot of business in one go. This is called as wholesale banking. And because of its attractiveness, because of its huge amount, huge valuation, huge amount of business, they are more attractive. The next term that we have is called as lead bank scheme. What exactly is lead bank scheme? It was started or launched in the year 1969. So lead bank scheme was launched in the year 1969. And it was based on the recommendations of Gadgil study group. What lead bank scheme said is that in rural and semi-urban areas, we need a lead bank. We need a bank. So let's say there is a rural area. Let's say we have Lonavala. Although it's a hill station, let's assume that it's a semi-urban or a rural area when it comes to the status of the people in there. Okay. So let's say we have Lonavala in Maharashtra. And there are 10 commercial banks presently operating in Lonavala. And SBI is the biggest bank in that area. So the district government, the local government, comes in and says that SBI is going to be the lead bank, which means that SBI is going to act as leader for coordinating the efforts of all the banks which are available in that district, in that area. And the lead bank will help coordinate the efforts in such a way that the flow of credit to various agricultural companies or farmers, small scale industries, and various other retail and wholesale loans are provided in a more efficient and equal manner, so that everybody can have access to the loan, whether it's a farmer, whether it's a small scale industry, whether it's individuals who are taking personal loans, housing loans, different kinds of loans. So the lead bank scheme was focused on creating lead banks which could take up the responsibility and act as leaders. So this is lead bank scheme, a similar scheme in name, lead bank scheme, that was lead bank scheme. And now we have local area banks. Local area banks. What exactly are local area banks? So local area banks are very similar to regional rural banks. The only difference is that regional rural banks are functioning only in rural areas, as the name itself suggests. Whereas lead bank, local area banks, not the lead bank scheme, local area banks function on rural as well as semi-urban areas. Okay. What exactly are local area banks? Local area banks are also small private banks, which are low-cost enterprises, which means they function on minimizing their cost, becoming or remaining efficient and competitive, so that they're able to mobilize as much rural savings as possible and then make them available as investments or lendings in the local area itself. This was, we can easily say, another class of another dimension or a class of niche banks. So along with regional rural banks, they were also created in the year 1996. So lead bank, local area banks were launched in 1996, lead banks scheme in 1969, and Regional Rural Bank Act was passed in the year 1975, and then they became effective in 1976. So remember these years are very important. Do not forget them. But at the same time, also understand and remember the differences in their functioning. How are they different from each other? The next and very important ones that we're going to cover, wherein a lot of students face confusion, is chit fund and nidhis. What exactly are chit funds? What are nidhis and how are they different from each other and how do they function? Let's say there are 10 individuals who know each other and they decide that every month they will be depositing 100 rupees each in, let's say they have created a gullak, okay, or a collection house. So it can be a person, it can be just all 10 of them doing it together itself, it can be anything. Let's say all 10 of them decide to collect 100 rupees each every month. That means 1000 rupees every month. Now what will happen is, where will this 1000 rupees go? There will be a chit, there will be a lottery which will be created, and every month all 10 of them, let's say they have given their names, and one will be taken out. Let's say first month one is taken out, it comes out to be number 6. So sixth person will be provided rupees 1000. Okay. And what will happen next month is, next month all of them again will deposit 1000 each. So this one will be depositing 100 again. He's already deposited 100 at the end of first month. So in net, he's received only 900. This is the first month. This is the second month. This is the third month. And so on, it will go till the month of 10. So that the price becomes equal. Price becomes equal to the output. So in short, the sixth person is also depositing 10 times rupees 100 each, that means 1000, but is received this 1000 in first month itself. Similarly, every month one person will be selected. Let's say in the second month, third person, the person with number 3, is selected, so he will be given rupees 1000, but every month he is also depositing rupees 100. So this is called as chit fund, whereas a fund is created, chits are created, and through this fund people are provided money. So what that does is, instead of all these people have only rupees 100 per month. So either they can save it themselves, this rupees 100 per month for the next 10 months. And after 10 months, all of them will have 1000 each. But it is very difficult to save money in this way, unless you have access to banking system. So in the olden times, chit funds used to be followed in India. Even now, they are being followed at household level in smaller areas, as well as housewives. A lot of housewives follow chit funds, wherein they save money, they pool it, and they give it out to one person. So this is called a chit fund. This is regulated under Chit Fund Act 1982. So there's a separate act which covers chit fund. On the other hand, nidhis is a class of NBFCs. It is regulated under the Companies Act 2013. How nidhis are different from chit funds are, nidhis are just like NBFCs, wherein they accept some money. They accept deposits from their promoters, from their members. So there are members in a nidhi. That's how it is different. And only members can deposit. Only members can deposit money in a Nidhi company, and Nidhi company can give out loan to anybody. So only members can deposit money. This ensures that the Nidhi company does not end up accepting deposit from strangers, from people who are not members of the Nidhi, and therefore it does not enter into any kind of fraudulent activity. They do not require any RBI license. They're regulated by Ministry of Corporate Affairs. That's how they're different. One more thing, any pool of Nidhi or chit fund which is more than 100 crore automatically comes under regulation of SEBI now, because of a lot of frauds which have been happening. So probably 2-3 years back, this was changed. Okay. Nidhis are also mutual benefit companies. Why mutual benefit? Because there are members who are depositors, and largely only members become borrowers. But at the same time, it is not like chit fund, because all the members are compulsorily not depositing the same amount every month. They can deposit whatever they want. They can loan or borrow whatever they want, given that the Nidhi company approves the loan. So this is how Nidhis function. They do not have a lot of rights, a lot of functions that NBFCs enjoy. And that is how they are also different from NBFCs. NBFCs are much larger in their functioning. The next one that we have is called as Asian Clearing Union. So let me just explain it to you verbally. Asian Clearing Union is a clearing union which is created to ensure that the members, there are a total of 9 members, all the members in the Asian Clearing Union can facilitate payments to each other on multilateral basis without having the need to use foreign exchange reserves. So let's say tomorrow India and Iran want to trade with each other. So India, Iran, let's say, is trading with Nepal, and Nepal is trading with India. So these three countries are trading with each other. India with Iran, Iran with Nepal, Nepal with India. India has to give, let's say, 10,000 rupees to Iran. And at the same time, India has to receive. So this is India, this is Iran, this is Nepal. So India has to give 10,000 rupees to Iran. Iran has to give, let's say, 20,000 rupees to Nepal. We are doing it in rupees. It would be otherwise in ACU or any other currency. And Nepal has to, let's say, give rupees 15,000 to India. So we will net out all this money. India has to give 10,000 to Iran. Nepal has to give 15,000 to India. We will net it out so that Nepal needs to give only 5,000 now, and 10,000 is deducted here, and now Iran has to give 10,000 to Nepal. So Nepal gets 10,000 from Iran, and India gets 10,000 from Nepal instead of getting 10,000 from Iran, and it gives 5,000 to Nepal. Iran receives 10,000 from India, and it has to give 20,000 to Nepal now. So it ends up giving 10,000 to Nepal, okay? Because it has netted. It does not receive 10,000 from India, but it gives 10,000 to Nepal. So that's how they net it out, and they enter into a multilateral transaction wherein they do not have to use foreign exchange reserves. Therefore, the costs of converting their domestic currency into a foreign currency is saved. And there are a lot of other benefits as well. The reliance on a foreign currency is also reduced. So this is called as Asian Clearing Union, which was created a long time back. The main purpose, I think it was created in 1974. The main purpose was to ensure that all these countries in the Asian area are able to trade within themselves without any need for relying on any foreign currency. The next term that we have is called as Hundi. What exactly is this Hundi? Let's try and understand this. Hundi is basically the traditional name of bill of exchange. If you do not remember what is a bill of exchange, let me explain that very briefly to you. I am an individual. Let's do not change my name. And let's say you are an individual here. Let's say Amir Khan. Okay, so you are, let's say, residing in the US right now, and I export certain goods to you. And in return, you have to pay me money. So I've exported certain goods to you, and in return, you have to pay me some money. Now you say that I can pay you this money only after 3 months. So for 3 months, let me issue a certificate to you which will be called as a bill of exchange, which will give you a written assurance that I will be paying you this entire due money in the next 3 months. If I don't pay, my bank will pay. That assurance is also provided. So this is a bill of exchange. When this was done at domestic level in India in the ancient times, it was called as hundi. So this is all there is to hundi. There is no legal status. They're not covered under Negotiable Instruments Act also. So it's an informal system of carrying out trading transactions with each other. Next, we have credit rating agencies. Only the names and their full forms are important. The first one is CRISIL, Credit Rating Information Services of India Limited. I'm not going to write the entire thing. You can read it on your own as well, because there's no analysis here. CRISIL, Credit Rating Information Services of India Limited. Then we have ICRA and CARE. So the second one that we have are ICRA and CARE, ICRA and CARE. ICRA stands for Investment Information and Credit Rating Agency, and CARE stands for a Credit Analysis and Research Limited. Okay. Then we have ONICRA, and then we have DFHI. DFHI is a Discount Finance House of India. It's a money market institution, the purpose of which was, it was created in 1988. So DFHI main purpose was to create a secondary market of money market instruments. Okay. So what are money market instruments? Instruments which are short term in nature. Let's say I'm a bank, you are another bank. I want money. You have a lot of money with you. I want money only for the next 2 days. So you send me, you lend me this money for the next 2 days. And I give you, let's say, a bond for the next 2 days. And I say that after 2 days, I'll purchase back this bond and I'll give you the money back. So that's a repurchase transaction happening between banks. There can be a bill of exchange which can be trading in a money market. In a secondary money market. So all this is done through Discount Finance House of India. And the next and last that we have is called as NEET. NEET is similar to Bolt. Bolt was the online system, automated trading system of Bombay Stock Exchange. Okay. Similarly, the automated screen-based trading system of NSE, National Stock Exchange, is called as NEET, National Exchange for Automated Trading. Okay, so NEET is similar to Bolt. Bolt is the automated screen-based trading system in BSE, and NEET is in NSE. That's the only difference. So there's no explanation to this that can be provided. Very simple to understand. Okay, so we're done with today's banking and finance important terms. I hope you liked it. I'll be discussing some more terms in the future videos as well. If you have any comments, any confusion, anything that you wish to know, you can mention them to me in the discussion forum or over Telegram. The links are available in description, or you can provide me comments. Okay. All the very best. Take care. Have a nice day.